Here we go. You're watching and listening to The Morgan Thomas Show with Big Al, my co-host and good friend, Alan Adams. Welcome to the show, Al.
Man, it's good to be here. It's a little bit different night for us tonight. I'm usually coming home from youth group right about now, but today I'm leaving Bible study a little bit early. And as we all know, God is a huge Clemson fan, so I think he's going to forgive me for that one.
If you're not familiar with The Morgan Thomas Show, it's myself. I'm the host and producer with my co-host, Big Al, Alan Adams. We go live stream on Facebook and on YouTube every Wednesday night at 8:30. Then we also, on Thursday nights at 8 p.m., we go and have our replays up on the Roar, 105.5 FM and 97.5 FM in Spartanburg. Typically, we go through three different subjects, and that's what we're going to do tonight. We're going to talk about the position grades and give our position by position grades for Clemson. All right, Al, so we're going to start off with the quarterback. Obviously, Trevor Lawrence, 17 for 25, 170 yards, three touchdowns, one interception. What kind of grade did you give him coming out of the Florida State game?
I gave him a B+. You know, I thought he looked much more composed in this game. You know, he was very comfortable, in part due to the offensive line, and they kind of resolved some of the issues they had the week before at North Carolina. You know, he didn't have any eye-popping stats, but he just played a little over a half. You know, I remember a bad pass or two. Obviously, he tried to force something and be a hero on the sideline, and it got picked off. But, you know, I'm kind of that guy. I hate to see him just run out of bounds in most instances. You know, I'm kind of the no guts, no glory kind of guy. I do like to see him make a play there. And he had a guy open. He just kind of underthrew him. But still, I gave him a B+. He did a pretty good job there. It's just the stats aren't going to kind of really pop out at you.
I went ahead and gave Trevor Lawrence a B. As you know, I don't do pluses and minuses. I don't like that. That's mixing math in there, and I don't like that. But I like Trevor. I like what he did. He had a good job passing the ball. Good job rushing the ball again, and seemed like he made some pretty good decisions throughout the game up until that one interception, which I still feel like is kind of boneheaded there. He's relying too much on his arm strength and his talent. But then again, as you were mentioning, I want him to rely on his arm strength and his talent. I want him to be, I don't want him to have to think about, should I not go for it? I want him to take risks and push the envelope on what his abilities can do. As far as the running back, you had Travis Etienne, 17 carries for 127 yards, 7.5 yards per carry. Lynn J. Dixon is another notable one, 10 carries, 49 yards for 4.9 yards per carry. What was your grade for the running back position?
I gave the running backs an A. You know, we talked about it last week. You know, the kind of point that I made was I expect Travis Etienne to have a big day. I think he's been a little frustrated with kind of his lack of plays, his lack of kind of really putting the team on his back. You know, he likes that. He enjoys that. And he had the day I expected. You know, he ran hard. He ran with a purpose, much harder than I have seen him in the past few games. And, I mean, he had a bullet of a pass on the second play of a game. I mean, he really reared back and threw that one, so I was very impressed with that. You know, I predicted that big game. You know, I was glad to see him back. It's good to have the old ETM back. Lynn J, obviously, you know, provided the good changeup as well as he usually does.
If you haven't checked out some of the offensive plays that I've put up on Twitter, it's at Clemson Morgan. There's one specific where Travis Etienne picks up a block for a touchdown from Lawrence to Ross, and he was a key player in that formation there to block that blitzing linebacker, and something that he kind of got picked on in the North Carolina game, and it's good to see him come back out and have a really solid game in the blocking side of things. He did great running the ball. I think that going back to the offensive coordinator side of things and the play calling, they came out in the pistol, which, you know, I love the pistol because it's more of a running back traditionally behind the quarterback. Mm-hmm. And Elliott came out and said it forces Trevor to just worry about handing the ball off. He doesn't have to worry about reading the defensive end or the edge linebacker or anything like that. He doesn't have to do the run-pass option. He doesn't have to do the read or anything. He just has to give the ball off. Most of those plays where he just had to do that, Travis Etienne did really well. One specifically I have over on the Twitter account, he went for 13 yards and a first down. Great, great decision there by Elliott to get back into that. Taj Boyd was so good in the pistol, so I want to see more of it. I think it was great. It's kind of like a Chad Morris thing, and I don't know why they haven't been doing it at the beginning. They kind of really relied on that shotgun option kind of formation or play, but I like to see what they're doing now. So I give Travis Etienne an A because Lynn J. Dixon also had some good running as well. So I like both of them. I think they did really well. As far as the wide receivers, had a bunch of good wide receivers out there. Justin Ross had 2 touchdowns. T. Higgins, Amari Rodgers both had 5 catches. What do you give the wide receiver group?
I gave the wide receivers a B+. You know, the quarterbacks kind of really spread the wealth out in this game. Nobody really shined for the most part. I mean, Higgins, Rodgers, Ross, and Ngata, they all kind of had, I think, somewhere between 35 and 62 yards apiece, something like that. So nobody had a huge game, 100-plus yards, the ones we're kind of used to seeing from Higgins especially. He's been kind of over that 100 mark all year, it seems like. But, you know, they did a good job of getting open, you know, making a few plays here and there, obviously with a few touchdowns you mentioned before. So overall, B+, not a bad day for the wide receivers.
Jumping over to the tight end core, really J.C. Chalk, a little bit of Price out there. Didn't really see much of them, much activity, especially in the first half. Mm-hmm. For me, I'm going to say, originally I kind of gave them a higher grade than this. I'm going to say a B just because I really didn't see much from them.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I did the same thing. You know, like you said, they had a couple of small receptions, Chalk with the first down catch, and there was another real short one, I think, for a couple yards in there, but they're non-existent in the passing game, as they typically have been. You know, a solid B, I will take that every time from our tight ends this year.
And as far as the offensive line, you know, they got picked on a lot last week. We gave them, I think you gave them a D, and I gave them a C last week. This week, I think they did better. They still had a bunch of unforced penalties, so I can't give them an A in that situation. They had a false start from Simpson, a false start from Savinka. Ankrum, I noticed missed a block on a crucial running down to the left side for, I believe it was a third down play, and he missed a block completely. Cade Stewart fell over on a couple of plays I watched. I was kind of disappointed in that. And a lot of times I noticed that on the right-hand side, you know how we talked about there's an issue on the right-hand side. We couldn't really pinpoint it. It seems to be that there has to be a lot of two-on-one, two Clemson players on one defensive end on the right side. For whatever reason, Simpson and Carmen can handle one-on-ones. But for whatever reason, on the right-hand side, it seems like the more plays I look through, it's two-on-ones over there. And in that situation, it's taking up a blocker and freeing up a linebacker, and that's why there's a lot more pressure on the running backs to pick those guys up. I wouldn't really give them a C in this situation because I felt like a team that puts up that many rushing yards and passing yards and no sacks, I don't believe he had any sacks, I'm going to give him a B.
Yeah, I did the same thing for a lot of the same reasons. I actually gave him a B+. You know, I think it's kind of one of the games we've been waiting on from these guys while knowing they can still do much better. They did a good job of run support, pass protection. You know, when Etienne has a good day and Trevor Lawrence has a good day and no sacks, I mean, that's obviously a testament to the offensive line, even if there are a few slip-ups and the penalties you mentioned.
And moving over to the defense, and if you're worried about for the defense, I'm going to tell you my front seven. The defensive line and linebackers, I'm going to lump them together because I gave them both an A. I think Tyler Davis did really good. I think XT did really good. Dabo's already bragging on XT and how he's way ahead of Isaiah Simmons at his age. The linebackers, Skalski was all over the field tackling literally everyone. Isaiah Simmons leading the way. You even had Kane Patterson, a third, fourth stringer out there tackling everybody. Chad Smith with an interception. So I give them both A's, defensive line, linebackers.
Actually, the defensive line, I gave an A-. You know, I thought they did a great job slowing down one of the best backs in the country in Cam Akers, you know, albeit against a bad offensive line for the Seminoles. You know, they really haven't been able to block anybody, and that trend has continued from last year. They had just over 100 yards rushing. A big portion of that was against the backups. So A-, a really solid job. It's just really hard to grade them, you know, A or A+ when you understand the competition they're playing. You know, it's hard to give them that when you know they're going against a bad offensive line for the Seminoles. Linebackers, you know, I was very impressed with the linebackers this game. Skalski, you said, was all over the place, did a much better job tackling. I don't recall calling out to, you know, my father-in-law, hey, another missed tackle, you know, by Skalski or whoever it might be, or Chad Smith, which is a great thing. You know, I've been kind of harping on that a bit this year. They did a much better job, and they're going to need to continue to do that.
As far as that back secondary with the cornerbacks and the safeties, I didn't see much wrong with the cornerbacks. I don't think Blackman or Alex Hornibrook really could handle what Clemson's defense brought to them. Mm-hmm. But I give the cornerbacks an A. Obviously, big thing, no issues. And Kendrick, man, with the pick six, the exciting pick six. You love to see those, and I want to see more and more of those. The safeties for me, you have another guy, Tanner Muse, with an interception, even though he was way off of coverage, And if the guy, if Alex had have thrown it correctly, it would have probably gone for a touchdown, but he threw 5-10 yards behind him and Muse just said, thank you, sir. So we'll take it. Right. But overall, Kayvon Wallace with consistent pressure, you've got.
Yeah. Quarterback. I gave it, as a matter of fact, I gave quarterback and safety both A's as well. You know, I thought they did a pretty good job against some talented receivers. Florida State does have talented receivers, especially Terry. You know, Kendrick had that big pick six. Like you said, I called for that pick six in week one. That was my bold prediction for week one. It did not happen, but it was good to finally see him get that opportunity because he's in position more often than not. So I'm hoping we'll get to see more and more of that kind of thing from him. You know, solid day for the safeties. Tanner Muse, like you said, got that interception. I think that was three on the day. Chad Smith, Tanner Muse, and Dereon Kendrick got the three interceptions for us. You know, Muse got healthy over the bye week, which was a big deal.
And then to wrap it all up with the special teams play, something that was really more controversial than it needed to be was the special teams play. A lot of Gamecock fans love to really pick on Dabo Swinney for coaching. Yep. I don't really get that. I actually was tweeted to, I believe it was Dustin Fry or whoever, whoever their kicker was a couple of years ago. The guy that was like 80 pounds soaking wet, you know, that kicker that they had. Yep. And he was talking junk about Dabo and how he's just treating his kicker completely wrong. And I don't believe that at all. I came out and said that, you know, everybody needs to be challenged in some way. And if your son or daughter has never gone through some sort of challenging situation where someone out of love is trying to make them be better or push them to be better or be a better version of themselves, then it shows. It shows to everybody else. It might not show to the parents, but it shows to everybody else around, hey, that person's never really been challenged in their life. They've never really been pushed to be successful. Yeah. So, but overall, BT Potter, he did miss the one, but Sawicki came in and made one, and then the punting job was good. They really didn't have to punt very much, but kickoff returns, not really doing much there. I want to see some electrifying kickoff returns or punt returns, just not seeing them. But I'll give them a B. I don't think they did anything too negatively bad or too overly positive.
Yeah, and actually, Elliott Fry is the kicker you're talking about for South Carolina. Dustin Fry was actually a former offensive lineman, I believe.
Yeah, I know. I was thinking Dustin and Roman is the offensive lineman. I get it, yeah. As far as helmet stickers and the $2 bill, helmet stickers we give to the top two players from our team, and the $2 bill we give it to the top player from the opposing team. For me, I have Amari Rodgers. I knew you were going to pick someone else, so I picked Amari Rodgers because he had one rushing touchdown for 29 yards. Really was more of a pass, but five catches tied the team with T. Higgins on the catches, and he's just so consistent right now. When you need him, he catches the ball, he gets you positive yards, and he can break tackles, and I really enjoy that about him. I'm welcome back, Amari. I'm glad that you're back from injury, and you're looking good. On the defensive side of things, DK with the pick six. I love him. I love pick sixes. I love DK because he reminds me of a Deion Sanders type guy that can play both ways. And Clemson is now tied for sixth in scoring defense. So go Tigers on that.
For offense, I chose Travis Etienne. You know, I talked him up the week before, so obviously I had to kind of go with him after he had just under 130 yards rushing, about 7.5 yards a carry, you know, and of course we've talked about a couple of times the pass he threw to Justin Ross. So he had a great day. Obviously, Travis is going to be my guy on offense. Defense, I went with Kane Patterson. You know, you kind of mentioned him when you were talking about the linebackers in our position grades. I really liked some of the plays that I saw him in on Saturday. He was really aggressive. He was around the ball. He had a sack and a tackle for loss, I believe. I'm really looking forward to seeing him develop because, as we know, it's really difficult for a freshman linebacker to come in and be in Brent Venables' scheme. But he seems to be grasping it pretty well. I'd like to see more and more of him as the year goes on, as obviously he learns the playbook a little better, adds some more bulk, and gets in there. But I really like what I saw from Patterson.
But my $2 bill, let me pull out my $2 bill here, Al. You see it on the screen there. My $2 bill is Hamza Nasiruddin. Did I say that right?
Yeah, I always called him Nasiruddin in the Nasiruddin process, but they called him something different on the PA system at the game, so I'm not really sure.
So we'll call him HN for Florida State. He's the only guy that I really felt like did anything that stuck out to me, which was get the interception from Trevor Lawrence, and he kind of stepped out of bounds, got 2 feet in, and then tiptoed to catch it out of bounds. So I got to say, hey, some good footwork there. So you get a $2 bill, sir.
Yeah, that's not too bad. I went with Janarius Robinson. He's a defensive end. He had 6 total tackles, 4 solo, and he forced a fumble. So there wasn't a lot, you know, like you said, as far as the Noles were concerned defensively. Clemson kind of did whatever they wanted, but he was a bright spot for the most part. So he got my $2 bill.
All right, everyone. Well, it's time to take a quick break. When we get back, we'll give you our Week 8 picks against the spread. Remember to check us out on The Morgan Thomas Show, Facebook, YouTube, and The Roar. We'll be right back after this.